Good morning. My name is Wendy van der Sande, and I'm Associate Professor of the Department of Medical Microbiology and Infectious Diseases. And for today's ACE lecture, I will tell you something about the disease mycetoma. This lecture belongs to the ACE Migratory Health and Tropical Diseases. And in this ACE, we focus on migratory health and infectious seen in the tropics. One of the importance of this ACE is that it's situated in Rotterdam, and with its international harbor and its international airport, Rotterdam is a hotspot for tropical infectious diseases. The disease mycetoma is one of the tropical skin infections. And as you can see on this patient, it has a big lesion on the skin of the foot. Mycetoma is a so-called neglected tropical infectious disease, and it can be found mainly in the tropical regions, including Mexico, Sudan, and India. So the disease mycetoma has a definition which is a big mouthful. It's a chronic subcutaneous disease characterized by the discharge of grains and purulent material through sinuses. But it's much easier if I just simply explain how this disease develops. So people in these regions often walk barefoot because they don't own shoes. And what happens then is that you can get a minor trauma, like for instance a thorn prick, which introduces the causative agent in the sole of your foot. You don't feel any discomfort. It's just like a normal thorn prick. But what happens actually inside your foot is that the microorganism starts to grow and develops into a small granule called a grain. On the top of the foot, you can see a small nodule, and people don't seek medical advice when they only have a small nodule on their foot. But with time, this nodule will start to grow. And as you can see in real life, it looks like this very big tumorous lesion on the foot. And even later in the disease, the bone will be invaded. And as you can see on this X-ray picture, the bone is actually destroyed by the microorganism. Mycetoma, since it's been caused by minor traumas, is found mainly on the extremities, so on the hand and the feet. And as you can see, 70% of the cases is found in the foot. It can be a very small nodule, as you can see on this picture, but it can also be a very extensive lesion when the lymph actually loses its functionality. And as you can see, it can also be found on the knee and on the hand. So how can we treat this disease? Currently, there's no very good treatment for mycetoma, but the typical patient starts with a course of antifungal agents, in this case, itraconazole. Then they are treated for 6 months, and after 6 months, they need surgery. And within this surgery, the majority of the lesion will be removed. If it's a small lesion, the complete lesion will be removed. If it's a larger lesion, you need multiple surgeries. After the surgery, you need an extra 6 months to a year of itraconazole treatment, because otherwise the infection will recur. Unfortunately, even with this treatment, which is lengthy and expensive for the patient, still only half of the patient is cured. The other half gets recurrent infections. And of these recurrent infections, roughly 6% actually has to undergo an amputation. And an amputation in countries like Sudan, that means severe social stigma and also loss of income and dependency on the family. So these patients really become depressed. So there's a very urgent need to identify a novel treatment for mycetoma. But with this novel treatment, we can't simply take another drug. We need to be sure that they actually work against the black grains. So what is a black grain? It's a black grain you can see actually here on the foot. It's the appearance of the fungus inside the tissue. And when we zoom into this foot, into the black grain, you actually can see that these dots are found inside the lesions. They're black, they're the size of a pepper ball, and they are very hard. So when you make an histological slide, you can actually see that the fungus is surrounded by host cells, and all those tiny dots you see surrounding this big round grain are the host cells, so you can imagine the size of this grain. And if you zoom into the grain, you can actually see the fungal hyphae embedded in a cement material. So you can imagine how difficult it will be for a medicine to reach this fungus. So to be able to design a novel therapy for mycetoma, we first needed to know how this lesion actually was made of. And we did this very simply with using histological stainings. So we started with a simple stain where you can see the grain and the infectious cells surrounding them. So we knew that the grain was surrounded by host cells. But surrounding these host cells, you also have a very thick collagen layer. And this collagen layer, that's like your skin. It's very difficult to penetrate. When we look inside the grain, you can actually see those hyphae here inside the cement material. But we didn't have a clue where the cement material was made from. So we did some stainings. One of the hallmarks was that this grain was very black. And black is a pigment or a melanin. And with the staining for melanin, it was positive. So indeed, melanin was part of the cement material. Another staining we did was to stain for chitin. Chitin is a component of the fungal cell, and it was also present in the grain. But as you can see on both pictures, it's only present in the grain, not in the tissue surrounding it. And finally, we also looked for metals, and calcium was also a very big part of the fungal grain. So with this information, we built this model. So we have inside the inner core at number 3, that's the fungus embedded in the cement material, surrounded by the host cells in number 2, and surrounding that, you see the collagen layer. So for a drug to be able to treat this patient, it first needs to penetrate inside the collagen layer, then it needs to penetrate inside the host cell layer, finally it has to penetrate inside the grain, and in the end, it also has to penetrate inside the fungal cell within the grain. And hopefully then it can kill the fungus. So for us, our drug discovery pipeline has several steps. First, we have an in vitro step where we look inside the fungus. Then we have an in vivo step where we actually look inside an invertebrate model. Then we go in vivo into a mouse model. And in the end, of course, we have to test our drugs clinically. So can a drug penetrate the fungal cell? And can the drug inhibit fungal growth? Those are the two questions we want to answer in our in vitro susceptibility assays. So how do we do this? Well, we culture our fungus in the lab, as you can see here on this agar plate. Then we have to make a fungal suspension. So we take the fungus out of this plate, make it into a culture media, and get small hyphal fragments, as you can see over there. These hyphal fragments we will divide into different tubes. And these tubes will have different concentrations of an antifungal agent. So on this side, you have a very low concentration. On the other side, where the bar is high, you have a very high concentration. Then we wait till the fungus grows, and we visualize this growth by using a viability stain. And as you can see, the well where the MIC is, so the minimal inhibitory concentration, that's the concentration of a drug where the fungus is actually inhibited in growth. So this principle we use to study how susceptible a fungus is towards antifungal agents. So, but which drugs should we test? Well, of course, the obvious one is to look for antifungal agents already used in clinical practice for other diseases. But if these are not sufficient, then we need to look at other medications called a repurposing screening. So these medications are used for the treatment of other diseases, or we can look at new compounds. So we started with the simple procedure. We looked at the already existing antifungal agents. And these antifungal agents can be grouped into 5 different classes. We have the azoles, terbinafine, amphotericin B, echinocandins, and 5-fluocytosine. And as you can see, this is the concentration of a drug needed to inhibit growth. And these are the values we found when you test 900 strains, and 90% of these strains are inhibited at this concentration. So we get a very low concentration for ravuconazole and the other azoles, a higher concentration for amphotericin B, which is the yellow bar, even higher for terbinafine. And if you look at the green and the red bars, those are not inhibited at all, not even at very high concentrations of their drugs. So the conclusion from this slide is that the azoles can penetrate Madurella mycetomata cells. The azoles can also inhibit the fungal growth. And ravuconazole is the most potent azole to inhibit growth. But can it also penetrate the mycetoma grain? That's the next question. So for that, we use our invertebrate model. This is the larvae of the greater wax moth Galeria melonella. And you can actually use these larvae to infect them with Madurella mycetomatis. And as you can see on that histological slide over there, you see a grain appearing inside the larvae. You can see it with the naked eye, but you can see it also under the microscope. We see the typical cement layer, we see the host cells surrounding this grain, and we even see a collagen-like layer surrounding those host cells. So for comparison, if we add this picture of the human grain, you see how similar it actually looks. So this model is a good model to see if a drug can penetrate the fungal grain. We cannot do this in vitro because a fungal grain is never formed in vitro. So to test if the drug can penetrate this grain, we actually give the larvae 3 injections on day 1, 2, and 3, and then we wait to look for larval survival. So here you see the survival lines of the larvae. So if you look at this black line, those are larvae treated with PBS, and PBS is a solvent, so they are not treated with any antifungal agent. And as you can see, within 8 days, all larvae die. In the red line, we treat our larvae with itraconazole, the drug currently used to treat mycetoma patients. And as you can see, the line looks very similar to the control line, and only 1 or 2 larvae are alive at day 10. Due to this high similarity, there was no statistical significant difference in larval survival between the control line and the itraconazole treated line. So itraconazole didn't do much. If we look at ravuconazole, we see that the red line is always higher than the black line, and that at the end of day 10, still roughly 30 to 40% of the larvae are still alive. This line was statistically different from the control line. So that means that ravuconazole did prolong larval survival and that ravuconazole did do better than itraconazole. So from this experiment, we could conclude that ravuconazole is able to prolong larval survival and itraconazole is not. But the next question is, can it also be used to treat mycetoma in patients? So for this, currently there's a clinical trial ongoing in Sudan, and Erasmus MC is a partner. So hopefully in a few years' time, so next year or the year thereafter, we will be able to tell if ravuconazole was indeed better than itraconazole. But what if ravuconazole is not a promised drug? We cannot sit and wait to see if some new drug comes on the horizon. We need to take action now. So for that, we started an open source drug discovery project called mycetos. And this project includes both repurposing screening and the screening of new compounds. So what is open source drug discovery? Of course, we all know how medications are developed. They are developed by pharmaceutical companies behind closed doors, all in secrecy, to protect the patents. Open source is actually the opposite. It is often initiated by academia. It's all in the open source, so they use platforms like, for instance, GitHub. And everybody can actually participate. So there are a few rules to obey if you do open source drug discovery. First, all data and ideas are freely shared. Anyone can participate, doesn't matter if you are a professor or a student. We actually have high school students participating in this project, and can also be from academia, but also we have some participants which are actually from pharmaceutical companies and who do this for a hobby. And there will be no patents. And this approach is especially appealing for tropical neglected diseases, for instance, because there's no gain in developing a drug for tropical neglected disease in the perspective of a pharmaceutical company. So what kind of pipeline do we use? Well, we start again with in vitro susceptibility testing, and then we go into the larvae to see if the drugs actually work against the grains. But then there's a split. If the compound is already far advanced, we can go into in vivo mouse models and finally into a clinical trial. If it's not that advanced, it's a chemical compound made by some chemists, then we go into the development of new compounds and start all over again till we have a lead compound. So in this project, we started actually with four open source drug discovery boxes. Those boxes were from Medicines for Malaria Venture, which is also a non-for-profit organization. Each of these libraries consists of 400 diverse compounds. So you have the pathogen box, the pandemic response box, and recently the COVID box. So what we did? First, we used one concentration of each compound to see if it would inhibit the growth of Madurella mycetomates in vitro. And in this plot, you see all these dots. Each dot represents one compound. So at 100% growth, it means that the compound doesn't inhibit or enhance the growth of Madurella mycetomates. If you have a growth of 200%, it means that that compound actually stimulates the growth of Madurella mycetomates. So we want to stay away from these compounds. But here on the bottom, you see actually compounds where there's 0% till 20% growth. So that means that these compounds can inhibit the growth of Madurella mycetomates. But there are quite a lot. So we actually used a second approach where we determined the concentration at which 50% of all cells in our tube were inhibited. And then you can see that there are a few dots over there which do inhibit growth, but at the lower concentrations. And these are the interesting ones to go further with. So we selected 32 of the most potent compounds. And here you can see those compounds. And we determined the inhibitory concentration. And what struck us again was that the azoles, which are the blue lines, are very potent. So you see a high activity of those azoles. And then we have the red bar and the dark blue bar. They actually work on the same biosynthetic pathway. So that's a very potent pathway. One other compound with a very low growth or a high activity was olorafim. So that's also an interesting compound. So the next step is to look if any of these compounds can penetrate the fungal grain. And these are actually data which we only generated a month ago. So 9 out of the 24 compounds tested were able to prolong larval survival. So they were able to penetrate the fungal grain. That was 3 out of the 7 azoles, olorafim, and these compounds. If you see a number here, that means that the compound is still in the development and doesn't have a proper name yet. So 2 of these compounds we selected for further study. The first one was olorafim. Olorafim did prolong larvae survival, as you can see over here. But interestingly, it also has a different mode of action than any of the other compounds. And what also is more interesting, it's currently into clinical investigations. Even our own hospital participates in the trial of olorafim. So for this one, we will select this route. So we will go into mouse models and then hopefully later on in a clinical trial. For the other compound is a fenery mole. And why did we choose this compound? Well, for the fenery moles, there's already a very large library available with 800 compounds. And we can use that compound to understand one very important key question. It allows us to decide which chemical properties are needed actually to penetrate the fungal grain. So for this, we used this part of the mycetos approach, and we did this completely open source. So we started with 35 compounds of that large 800 compound library. And of those, 5 were tested against the larvae. And then we analyzed the data in comparison to the size of the molecule, the weight of the molecule, and how much it liked lipids. So as you can see here, survival was plotted against the size of the molecule, but there's no clear-cut correlation there. The same with the weight of the compound. But when we looked at lipophilicity, you see that there's a small curve over there, and that if we do statistical analysis, there seems to be a correlation over there. We confirmed this also by the azoles, and the same type of correlation was there. So we defined a chemical rule, and this chemical rule was compounds which don't like lipids that much are more likely to penetrate the mycetoma grain. So to check if this chemical rule was actually valid, we used an open source approach. From the 800 compound library, we actually asked scientists all over the world via GitHub, which compounds should we test next? And via GitHub, a list of compounds was made by several chemists in the world. And 73 of these compounds were obtained from the collection from DNDi, Drugs for Neglected Diseases Initiative. Furthermore, there were 2 chemists in this consortium which were willing to make new molecules. One was based at University College in London, and the other one was based at the University of Sydney. And these 2 chemists actually started to make new molecules based on the chemical rule we have set. So in total, 116 compounds were again tested in vitro and later on in vivo. From these compound screen, 4 out of the 16 compounds prolonged larvae survival. And since these data were only generated 2 weeks ago, we're still analyzing the data. And we are analyzing these data in correlation to log-D, so how lipophil are these compounds, and the size and weight. And in the end, this data will be used to define the chemical properties needed first to penetrate the fungal cell, but more interestingly, to penetrate the fungal hive, the fungal grain. So this chemical rule will be able to help us to either design new molecules for mycetoma treatment, but also to adapt existing molecules to be able to penetrate more easily inside the lesion and inside the grain. And this will lead to more effective drugs. So that this little boy with mycetoma no longer has to fear for large surgeries or even amputations, because our goal will be no amputations for mycetoma. Since I've mentioned that this is an open source drug discovery project, and it doesn't matter if you're a student or a PhD student, or even a professor, everybody can participate. So if you're interested in this project, please visit us either on Twitter, GitHub, and you can find our publications over there as well as in PubMed. Well, I would like to thank the audience for listening, and I hope that in the future, this patient with this large lesion can be treated with novel drugs for mycetoma, which will be able to penetrate all the way inside the fungal grain. Thank you for your attention, and please join us all on GitHub.